heavens and the earth, the ever-living, he is the first. He's the owner of mercy. He sent his messenger.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome, brothers and sisters, again to another episode in the series Gardens of the Righteous, where we shall be going through Riyad al-Salihin by Imam al-Nawawi with our Sheikh, Sheikh Haytham al-Haddad. Sheikh Haytham is currently residing in the UK and is on the board of the Islamic Sharia Council of Britain and is also the founding member of the website www.islam21c.com. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
We've just started to touch onto the second chapter, which is the chapter of Tawbah. Before we continue, I just want to read the English translation for our audience who are just joining us
okay.
for the first time. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu relates that he heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, Allah is my witness that I seek his forgiveness and turn to him more than 70 times a day.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulillah. This is the chapter of Tawbah, and An-Nawawi rahimahullahu ta'ala, the author, he mentioned the first chapter on sincerity, and then he is mentioning the second chapter here on Tawbah. We explained why is this, and we said that it is the first step a person may take towards Allah Jalla wa'ala. And we commented on some of the verses that were included, the Quranic verses that were included in the beginning of this chapter, or Imam al-Nawawi quoted them. Now, one of the verses that he quoted is from chapter al-Tahrim, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا تُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ تَوْبَةً نَصُوحًا. All believers, repent to Allah Jalla wa'ala, a tawbah that is nasuh. Nasuh means pure, sincere, committed, strong.
With ikhlas.
With ikhlas. This scholar said, what is the tawbah? That is nasuh. They said the tawbah that meets three conditions. First of all, if the person is committing a sin now, it doesn't make sense that he's committing the sin now and he's continuously doing the sin and he claims that he is repenting from that sin. So the first step is?
To stop doing it.
To stop doing it. Okay? So this is the first step. The second step, as the scholar said, it doesn't make sense at all that the person stops doing it and he wants to repent, but he knows and he wants to do it again. He not only knows, but he also wants to do it again.
So there's no regret.
Not only no regret. So what do you mean by tawbah? You want to do it again. No, this is not tawbah. You are not repenting. So you have to what? To have commitment in your heart. Not just by your tongue. No, by your heart that, ya Allah, I don't want to do it again.
So sincere dedication that you will not continue the sin.
Yes, sincere dedication that you will not continue or repeat the sin. The third condition is that you feel bad that you did it.
This is the remorse side of things.
The remorse side. Why is this? Because if you don't feel that it was something bad, you don't want to do it again, yes. But you don't feel the remorse that you have done it, that you have violated the law of Allah Jalla Ala, that you have displeased Allah Jalla Ala, that you have incurred the anger of Allah Jalla Ala. You don't feel anything about it. This is not tawbah. This is not tawbah that Allah Jalla Ala will accept. And as the scholar said, at-tawbatu an-nasuh. Yeah, as it was mentioned in one of the hadith, although might not be very strong, at-ta'ibu min al-dhanbi kaman la dhanba lah. Some scholars said that it is strong hadith. So it doesn't make sense that the person is repenting and he doesn't feel remorse or regret for whatever he has done.
No guilt.
No guilt. This is not tawbah. That's why once all these conditions are there, the three conditions, that the person is stopping the sin and the person is committed and dedicated internally, that he will not do it again. And the person is regretting that he has done it before. This is the tawbah نصوح, the three conditions are met, then what will happen? As if the person did not do the sin. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, التائب من الذنب كمن لا ذنب له. This is a sound hadith reported by Ibn Majah and others. التائب من الذنب, the one who repents from a ذنب, is if he did not commit it. Subhanallah, this is a big issue. This is a big reward. That after the person commits the sin, if he regrets and he promises Allah Jalla wa Ala internally, he's dedicated that he will not do it again. Yeah? And obviously he stopped it. Subhanallah, Allah Jalla wa Ala will wipe it, will clean it as if he did not do it. So these are the three conditions. The scholars also said that there is a fourth condition in some situations. If this sin involves taking or violating the right of other people, you need to fix the situation with them if possible. So if the person, he has taken the money unlawfully from others, this involves two types of sins. First of all, he violated the law of Allah and he violated the rights of others. Subhanallah, look at the justice of Allah Jalla wa Ala. It is confirmed in number of ahadith that Allah Jalla wa Ala forgives the sins between him and the person other than shirk. But the sins where the person has violated the rights of others, Allah Jalla wa Ala will forgive his side and Allah Jalla wa Ala will not forgive the other side because the person has to give the other person his right. Either he should give it to him in the dunya or it will be taken from him on the day of resurrection.
So make sure that you sort it out in this.
And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a very beautiful hadith, من كان له عند أخيه مظلمة فليستحل له من قبل أن يأتي دينار ولا درهم. So the one who committed injustice against his brother, he took his money unlawfully, or maybe he was backbiting him, or he slandered him, or he did anything wrong against him. Yeah? He should ask him to free him from the responsibility. This is what the Prophet ﷺ said. Before the day of resurrection, where there is no compensation by money, there is compensation by what?
Deeds.
By deeds. By Jannah and Nar. And that's why in the other hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, shall I tell you about the muflis? The muflis, muflis in our language, means bankrupt.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Bankrupt. He doesn't have money anymore. This is in our language.
So he had money, but now he doesn't.
He used to have money, and now he doesn't. Subhanallah. It is the same. How? The muflis on the day of resurrection is, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the person who brings salah and siyam and hasanat. But he violated the right of this person. He took the money of this person. He slandered this person. He committed sins related to the other people. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what will happen? His deeds will be distributed to them. His deeds will be given to them. And once his good deeds are over, what will happen? Allah will take from their bad deeds, from their sayyat, and put on him instead of taking hasanat from him because he has no more hasanat to beat him.
Subhanallah.
And as a result of this, he will be thrown into the fire of hell. So that's why the scholar said, if the sin involves the rights of others, then make sure that you fix it with the others. How? Either you return the money, you return the wealth, or ask them for forgiveness. Yeah? Akhi, wallahi, I have taken this money from you, take it back. Or, akhi, wallahi, I was backbiting you. I ask you for forgiveness. Or I slandered you, or I have done this for you. Please forgive me.
So this is one half of the tawbah.
This is part of the tawbah. In order for the tawbah to be a valid tawbah, tawbah nasuh, yes, and the ma'asiyah. Yeah, the ma'asiyah, the sin that the person committed and he wants to repent from, involves violating the rights of others, then he should fix it. So this is the fourth condition. So now we have four conditions for what? أو التوبة النصوح. Once the person has a توبة نصوح, then what? Inshallah, the sin will be wiped out and cleaned. التائب من الذنب كمن لا ذنب له, as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said.
Subhanallah, it's another mercy from Allah.
Yes, another mercy from Allah.
Jazakallah khair. Brothers and sisters, please come back to us in the discussion after the break, where we shall continue on the chapter of repentance, or the chapter of Tawbah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Evangelatos.
Somebody has all the material needs at their disposal,
yes,
and they're still unhappy. That's when we come in as Muslims to give them the message of Islam. This is the point.
Sheikh Karim Abu Zaid.
The highest income in the face of this earth is in a country called Sweden. The highest suicide, where?
Sweden.
Where? Sweden. Sweden.
Shun immorality. Seek forgiveness. Spread righteousness.
The hearts of the human are in between two fingers of Allah. Now if you submit to Allah, Allah will place that serenity, that tranquility in your heart. In your heart.
Let's speed up to please Allah.
Your heart finds peace. This is what the people are missing. This is what the people in the West are missing. They are waiting,
they
for,
are
us
waiting for us
to tell them about
to
it.
Tell them about
Feel the passion of believers to get the blessings of Allah in Hasten to Goodness. Tomorrow at 4:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 3:30 a.m. India on Peace TV.
Most countries of the world ban bullying. They fight it in their schools and universities. A lot of us are being bullied differently every single day. Some come up to us and say, do this, while others say, don't you dare. Some say this is halal, halal, while others say, nope, this is haram. Haram. Are you confused? Are you confused? Do you feel lost? Join me in Umdatul Ahkam, where, with the grace of Allah, we will learn the proper knowledge from the Quran and from the Sunnah, which would help stop this kind of bullying.
Join Asim Al-Hakim in Umdatul Ahkam, next on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome again, brothers and sisters, to this discussion on repentance. Discussion on Tawbah. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
We have just started talking about the hadith. Is there anything else you want to mention about the first hadith in this chapter?
Yeah, there is a lot to be mentioned about this hadith. Okay? And a lot to be mentioned about Tawbah, but inshallah, yani some of the things will be mentioned throughout the chapter. But we said that there are four conditions for the Tawbah to be, inshallah, accepted and valid. Okay? The first condition is to stop the sin that you are committing. The second is to have commitment that you will not do it again. And the third condition is to regret that you have done it previously. And the fourth one is a condition that needs to be fulfilled if your sin involves the rights of others. Now, what will be the result of the tawbah? The sin, inshallah, will be what?
Wiped.
Will be wiped. Now, is there any indication that your tawbah is accepted? This is a very common question. And there might be some indications, as some scholars said, but there is no confirmation. Why is this? Because the indications will encourage you. The confirmation might discourage you because you will say, well, khalas, my sin has been forgiven, or my sins have been forgiven. And this makes the person lazy and arrogant.
You'd be overconfident.
And overconfident. And in Islam in general, there is no confirmation of acceptance of deeds. There is no confirmation of acceptance of tawbah. There is no confirmation that the person will go to Jannah. Again, there is no confirmation that this person who is alive now and he didn't die on kufr, there is no confirmation that this person will die on kufr and will go to hellfire. Why is this? Because this dunya is darul imtihan and we will be tested. Okay. Now, tawbah, as we said, it is the first step the person should take in order to go to Allah Jalla Ala. Now, it is the first step, and it is the second step, and it is the third step, and it is the final step. And the person has to continuously repent to Allah Jalla wa Ala. Allah Jalla wa Ala commanded Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam to make istighfar. وَاسْتَغْفِرِ اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. Seek forgiveness of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Allah Jalla wa Ala is oft forgiving. Allah Jalla wa Ala is most merciful. We all read, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحُ رَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ
وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ
إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. It is very strange that when you see people are coming to Islam, yeah? وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. They are coming to Islam, which means the victory of Islam. Humble yourself before Allah. Sabbih. Exalt Allah Jalla wa Ala. And confirm the perfection of Allah Jalla wa Ala. This is tasbih. Ya Subhanallah. Wastaghfir. Innahu kana tawba. And seek forgiveness. Because Allah Jalla wa Ala is oft forgiving. Allah Jalla wa Ala. Tawwab means accept. Allah Jalla wa Ala accepts repentance. And Allah Jalla wa Ala wants people to repent, as we will see in the Ahadith. And that's why we see that istighfar is not necessarily from sins. Yeah? Istighfar is also an act where we seek istighfar from shortcoming in good deeds, as we will see. Here, let me mention that this scholars differentiated between tawbah and istighfar. They said that tawbah, you repent from what you have done. Istighfar is you ask Allah Jalla wa Ala for forgiveness. Some scholars said that istighfar is the same as tawbah. Some scholars said, no, there are differences. Because the person sometimes will commit a sin and from experience knows that it is likely that he is going to do it. He will seek forgiveness for it. And he's worried about himself. And he cannot make it sincere and strong tawbah. Subhanallah, Allah Jalla wa Ala didn't say that you don't have any chance. No, you have a chance. Make istighfar. Look at the rahmah of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And that's why Allah Jalla wa Ala says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. Allah will not punish the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as far as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is among them. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. Allah Jalla wa Ala will not punish us as far as we are making istighfar.
Subhanallah, we have so many times where we just sitting down doing nothing.
Say Subhanallah. That's why, Subhanallah, what you said. طُوبَى لِمَنْ وُجِدَ فِي صَحِيفَتِهِ اسْتِغْفَارًا كَثِيرًا. طُوبَى either the Jannah or a big tree in Jannah. Normally it refers to, ooh, what a good tiding. Yes? What a good glad tiding. For the person whom, yeah, it was found in his records, a lot of istighfar. Yeah? And we will see some of the virtues of istighfar. Now the hadith, this hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was commanded to make istighfar, himself is saying, by Allah, I swear by Allah, that I make istighfar and tawbah to Allah Jalla wa Ala every day, minimum 70 times. And as we said, if this is the case with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all his sins were forgiven, then what about us? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned it to us in order for us to follow his example. In order to follow his example. In fact, one of the companions, Abdullah ibn Umar, said, Wallahi, in kunna lana'iddu fi في مجلس رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, we used to count that in one meeting the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying أستغفر الله وأتوب إليه 100 times.
And we forget.
And we forget.
Or we think we don't need it.
This is the worst thing.
Arrogance again.
Arrogance again. And that's why when Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها said, Ya Rasulullah, why are you observing Qiyam al-Layl? Your feet are swollen. All your sins were forgiven. He said, shouldn't I be a thankful servant of Allah جل وعلا? So this is another angle of it. So this is the hadith about istighfar. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that I make istighfar and tawbah to Allah جل وعلا more than 100 times a day. All of us need tawbah, whether we remember an evil deed or we don't remember an evil deed.
This is another thing. We might not know what sin we have done.
Yes, that's why, as we will see, that it is good for the person to seek forgiveness from Allah Jalla wa'ala for all of his wrong deeds and to seek forgiveness from Allah Jalla wa'ala for the sins that he is unaware of. Yeah? And that's why in the dua, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to say, وَأَسْتَغْفِرُكَ مِمَّا لَا أَعْلَمْ. I seek your forgiveness from the sins I don't remember. Now, with regards to tawbah, tawbah is a manifestation of the rahmah of Allah Jalla wa'ala, as we will see. Because Allah Jalla wa'ala does not want to punish people, so he opened the door for them to make tawbah. Allah Jalla wa'ala opened the door for them to make what? Istighfar. Allah Jalla wa'ala is the one who created us with these weaknesses and these desires, but out of his mercy, he knew that we will commit sins, and the key thing is we should make istighfar.
He gave the opportunity.
He gave us the opportunity, and that's why it is authentically reported that if you do not commit sins and you do not make istighfar, Allah Jalla wa'ala would have replaced you with people who will commit sins and make istighfar. Because making sins is a human reaction. The key thing is to avoid major sins, to avoid swimming with sins. But sins here and there, they will be committed. Allah Jalla wa'ala knows that. So Allah Jalla wa'ala wants us to seek forgiveness for these sins. In fact, Allah Jalla wa'ala always encourages people himself to seek forgiveness. We mentioned that Allah Jalla wa'ala sent the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to encourage people to do istighfar. Hud alayhi salam encouraged people to make istighfar. Allah Jalla wa'ala mentioned about the disbelievers themselves, the mushrikeen, that he himself encouraged them to do tawbah. Look, Allah Jalla wa'ala addressed the disbelievers, the mushrikeen, the kuffar, those who insulted him. لَقَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ ثَالِثُ ثَلَاثَ. This is an insult to Allah.
Big insult.
To claim that Allah is not one. Allah is three and he is the third of a three. لَقَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ ثَالِثُ ثَلَاثًا وَمَا مِنْ إِلَهٍ إِلَّا إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ وَإِنْ لَمْ يَنْتَهُ عَمَّا يَقُولُونَ لَيَمَسَّنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. If they don't stop, yes, then Allah will punish them severely. لَيَمَسَّنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Then Allah Jalla wa'ala said, أَفَلَا يَتُوبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ.
Subhanallah,
amazing. Shouldn't they repent to Allah? Yes. أَفَلَا يَتُوبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ. And shouldn't they ask Allah Jalla wa'ala for forgiveness? Because Allah Jalla wa'ala is غفور رحيم. Subhanallah. Look at the forgiveness of Allah Jalla wa'ala. After insulting him, he is the one is telling them, go back and seek forgiveness. Go back and repent. And Allah is غفور رحيم. He concluded the ayah by saying that Allah is oft forgiving, most merciful. He didn't conclude the ayah by saying that Allah is severe in punishment. Insha'Allah, we will comment on this ayah and other ayat about istighfar and tawbah later, inshallah. Jazakallah khair.
Jazakumullah khair, brothers and sisters, for attending this discussion with us on the second chapter of Riyadh al-Salihin, which is the chapter of repentance, or the chapter